Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the L. Ron Hubbard Theater in Hollywood, California. Tonight we present a live broadcast of the Golden Age Radio Hour featuring L. Ron Hubbard's Western story, Cattle King for a Day. Chinook Shannon was new to Montana. He did not know the simple courtesies connected with the meeting the road agents. In fact, he did not even know the term, being from Arizona, where road agents are just plain bandits. All Chinook Shannon knew was that the man who had so suddenly leaped out in the trail before him was meant no good either to his person or his property. It was impossible to get by. Chinook crooked a heel around his saddle horn, extracted a sack full of Bull Durham tobacco, and built himself a smoke, keeping his eye upon the three holstered guns without seeming the least bit worried. Only the man's gun showed any care, and that glittered, polished with long and frequent usage.
You're the stranger.
Yep.
From desert country, judging the rig.
Yeah.
And you come a long ways fast.
100% so far. Long as we're telling fortunes, will I marry a blonde or brunette?
Neither. You ain't gonna live that long if you keep up on this trail.
If I'm not mistaken, this is the public thoroughfare to Bull Butte.
You ain't going to Bull Butte.
Now, I wouldn't say that.
You're gonna turn around and head south again, or else.
Else what?
Else. We'll cave in a bank on you, that's what.
Think there's enough of you to do that?
Plenty.
Sure you haven't got me tangled with somebody else?
Nope. According to a pal in Cheyenne, you're a Chinook Shannon.
It's Chinook. Pleased to meet you.
Yeah? I'm Jake Humphrey. Brad Kendall says you ain't going to arrive in Bull Butte.
He's wrong. But thanks for the trouble, and, thanks for the name.
What name?
Brad Kendall's name. I was the least bit hazy on who to look for.
Chinook set his toe back in the stirrup, took a long puff on the cigarette, flipped it down toward the stream, and gave every appearance of a man about to ride straight ahead. Jake kept his ground.
I wouldn't want you to get hurt. But
his hand ripped inside his coat and steel flashed as his short gun came out. Chinook dug spur. His horse, Wildcat, reared. Chinook's Peacemaker spewed thunder, flame, and lead. Ah! Humphrey's short gun leaped sideways and into the brush. Chinook crouched low over Wildcat's mane. He careened around a turn in the wooded trail, plunged off at right angles on a less distinct path, and raced ahead. Chinook continued toward Bull Butte, choosing his own way. Very puzzled as to the meaning and just why a man named Brad Kendall should desire his untimely demise.
Very strange,
he told Wildcat.
Maybe Banker Borden can clear it all up for me.
With that in mind, he entered the thriving town of Bull Butte. The metropolis consisted of two slovenly rows of buildings, weathered false front buildings. At the end of one hoof pulverized street was a squat, fort-like affair, quite obviously the bank. Chinook swung off, hitched Wildcat to the rack, and then entered the heavy door. There was a swinging gate and a sign which said, Paul Borden, President. Without waiting for an invitation, Chinook pushed through, tilted his hat onto the back of his head, and said,
Howdy.
Banker Borden looked up. No sign of recognition could be detected on his ruddy, soft face. Somewhat annoyed at the intrusion, he said briskly,
You wish to see me about some business?
Yep.
I don't seem to place you. Are you one of Kendall's men?
Nope.
Well, then, where are you from?
Arizona.
Borden paled slightly. Shakily, he removed his glasses, polished them, and looked fixedly at Chinook. He saw a sight which did not encourage him at all.
You're You're Chinook Shannon.
Yeah.
And you come to see about the Slash S Ranch.
Yep.
But I wired you about your grandfather's death 2 months ago.
Yep.
Well, see here, Shannon. You can't keep a man in suspense like that for 2 months and then suddenly turn up. You know, something had to be done about the Slash S.
Yeah. I'm gonna do it.
Why, yes, of course, Shannon.
Of course, I believe you said my grandfather died.
Oh, well, that's right.
Murdered, perhaps.
Why no? What makes you think that?
Shannons ain't like other people. They don't die natural deaths. I believe I'm the heir.
Oh, yes, sole heir of the Slash S.
I believe that it's the biggest spread east of the mountains.
Well, yes.
There were, last time my granddad wrote, about 4,000 head of good beef cattle there, which he was to ship in the fall.
Well,
did he ship?
No, that is, his death was a very great shock to all of us, Mr. Shannon. I think the country sustained a great loss.
Why didn't he ship?
Well, perhaps I had better start at the beginning, Mr. Shannon. You, I believe, were about to come north anyway to take over your grandfather's ranch and run it for him. He said as much.
And he figured he was getting old. Me, I've always been a drifter, and I always wanted to be one of those things they call a cattle king. Now, you savvy?
Well, yes, of course. Your grandfather was very fond of you, I believe.
Down Texas way when I was a little shaver. Yeah. Now, come on. What happened to the shipment? Train wreck? Rustling what?
Gordon squirmed and looked beadily at Chinook's peacemaker pistol. Taking a long breath, he plunged.
There's been some trouble, Mr. Shannon. Montana is divided into three lines of endeavor. Sheep, cattle, and mining. Sometimes, Mr. Shannon, those three come into conflict. In this instance, it was cattle and mining.
Go on.
Well, the Shoshone Mining Company discovered a rich lode up in Pan Creek. A stream of water which bisects the Slash S. Properly speaking, Mr. Shannon, the ground did not exactly belong to your grandfather, but the water below it did.
Go on.
Now, you're not a mining man, Mr. Shannon, but you must understand that minerals have the upper hand over mere cattle land. And you must understand that the wealth of the state depends on gold mining at the moment. You have heard of cyanide mining?
Nope.
Oh, well, it's a process lately introduced to Montana. Cyanide is utilized to remove the gold content from the crushed ore. Unfortunately for your grandfather's ranch, a great deal of this cyanide was swept away by the stream known as Pan Creek and was carried down into the watering pools. Cyanide, Mr. Shannon, is extremely poisonous. The cattle, Mr. Shannon, are dead.
4,000 head?
I regret to say.
Said Banker Borden, his eyes on the gun.
Well, but there's a chance to get more stock and to stop the spilling of this stuff into Pan Creek.
My bank, most unfortunately, holds the paper on the Slash S to the amount of $26,000.
Well, we'll fix that somehow. I want to roam around a little. I got an idea, Borden, that this ain't exactly 52 cards in the deck.
Young man, do you mean to implicate...
Yep.
Well, I must inform you that I mean to foreclose at noon tomorrow. The sheriff has already issued the papers.
No chance you might grant an extension.
Business is business.
You can call it by that name. It's almost noon now. You mean to say that for 24 hours... I am the owner of the Slash S?
Well, I've already probated, awaiting your signature. But I hardly think that it'd be worth your while, unless you have $26,000 on your person.
Give me your pen.
Chinook turned the legal document around. He looked it over. He saw that it looked all right. And he signed.
Oh, I think that you're being very foolish. 24 hours is very little time. And I would suggest...
Suggest anything you want. But wait until I've got a little more time.
Chinook Shannon walked out. Bull Butte at midday seemed to be populated principally with four dogs. Except for these, Chinook only saw the weathered buildings and, of course, his horse, Wildcat. Finding no one at home in the livery stable, Chinook took the liberty of bedding and feeding his worthy mount, and when that was completed, he walked through the dusky, dusty building toward the front door. Now, if rattlesnakes could talk, their voices would probably have resembled that which came from the shadows of a stall.
Going someplace, Shannon?
Chinook did not make a sudden movement. He stopped and leaned against a 2x4. He looked steadily in front of him. Two clicks followed, of a lethal quality, peculiar to a Colt pistol. The voice's owner stepped into Chinook's view.
I'm Kendall Shannon. I'm Brad Kendall. And there ain't a tougher gent west of the Mississippi, see? I'm Poison. You heard of me. Sure. Sure, I heard of you. That horse back there just now described you perfectly.
Kendall juggled his gun and his grin broadened. Suddenly, he understood what Chinook meant, and he lurched forward, hand tightening on the butt.
You're one of these smart Southerners, are you? One of these fast-draw, hell-on-wheels Texas boys, are you? You come here maybe to show us a few things? I did. Well, I bet your mama don't know you're out. How come my boys didn't stop you? Never mind, shuck that belt, and we'll get going. I'm staying where I am, Kendall. Huh? Well, what the hell, it don't make no difference where I get you. I just wanted you to know what happens to gents that come snooping around. That's all. You got a nerve with you, sonny. You know I got 20 guns that says I'm right. And more than that, I got me. What I do in this country is the law. One Shannon's already been convinced, and here's where I convince another.
As he spoke, his finger was tightening, and the muzzle was gradually coming up to a sight on Chinook's heart. Chinook tried to think of something. I mean, if he stepped aside and drew, it would still be too late. There was no way to beat the hammer. Another voice whined.
What the hell are you up to, Kendall?
Kendall whirled and stared at a man who stood just inside the livery stable door. Kendall glared at the newcomer's gun and lowered his own into his holster. There was nothing else he could do. Across the street, the swinging doors of the Diamond Palace jumped outward. Two hard-looking riders strode down the steps and started to cross the street. Chinook did not have to be told that these were part of Kendall's outfit. Somehow, all of Kendall's men were of a similar stamp. Chinook flipped through, he grabbed Kendall's gun, and tossed it into a pile of straw.
Come on, don't just stand there gawping. We gotta get the hell out of here before those two arrive.
Led hurriedly out through the rear of the building, Chinook had no time to speculate upon his savior's identity, and the man seemed to take it as a matter of course that Chinook knew. They skirted the back of the livery stable, walking over piles of rubbish, and at the man's request entered another, smaller shack, which had barred windows. A man with a big nose and flappy jowls looked up from a newspaper at the two callers. A large star was prominent upon his chest.
Oh, hello, Deke,
said Sheriff Taggart.
Well, who's your friend?
Well, he's Chinook Shannon. Can't you tell it? He always was blind in one eye. You gotta give him a hand. Kendall was trying to knock him over in the barn over there.
Oh, my, my,
said the sheriff, rubbing his nose and looking apprehensively at the door.
Do you suppose that they know he came in here,
no,
Deke?
No. They think maybe he rode away. Shannon, inside of his Jackrabbit expression on his face, This is Sheriff Taggart. Your grandpappy put him in office.
Chinook shook Taggart's flabby, wet hand.
In case your grandpappy never mentioned me to you, I'm Deacon Murphy. I'm his foreman.
Pleased to meet you. Now that we're all properly introduced, let me inquire about this Kendall. How come he's running Bull Butte?
Took over this spring. The son of a jackass took over a mine up in Pan Creek. Poisoned all of our stock with cyanide. Raised hell in general. Damn him, he didn't fight fair. He murdered your grandpappy. Went over the rest of us like prairie fire. Those boys scattered to hell and gone, but I've hung around Bull Butte for 2 months, waiting for you to come. Now that you're here, we only got a day, and we can't do anything in that length of time.
How about the courts?
When the circuit judge came, Deke Murphy was the only witness that could be got.
Because you was too scared to testify. But what are you going to do?
Murphy, the least I can do is nail the man that shot my grandfather.
Kendall.
And I can at least make a try to save the slash S.
Borden's got his bug eye on it. Yes,
he does. I know. I've talked to him. Murphy, all my life I've wanted to be what they call a cattle king. I've drifted around and I've never really amounted to much. Well, I'm one now. If only for 24 hours. Sheriff, if I shoot it out with this crowd, where do I stand with you?
Oh, well, well, that is, if you were to get all of them, Shannon, all of them, I think you would find me quite agreeable, but I cannot countenance any slaughter which would fail to clean out all of them. I mean, you are, after all, Shannon, but one man, and they are 21, I'm afraid.
You don't have to tell him how scared you are. Now, if we get them all, is that to be an even break in the eyes of the law?
Oh, no, an uneven break. An uneven break, if you'd ask me. I am afraid, Deke, that this young man is committing suicide.
That's my lookout. First, Murphy, we'd better look over the slash S and that mine. Sheriff, you'll please give us a hand in getting our horses?
Not me.
And you cover me, Murphy. Daylight's burning. Mm-hmm.
Chinook Shannon and Deke Murphy got out of Bull Butte with very great caution. It was no part of their plan to get killed. And at their moment of departure, that is, Kendall and his outfit were coming, combing the town with just that idea in mind. They rode circuitously in the direction of the Slash S, some 5 miles from Bull Butte. They pulled up on the rim of the butte, and Deke made an expansive motion with his hand.
There is the Shannon domain. Everything you can see from here, it's yours.
Chinook shaded his eyes with his hat and stared far out across the wide plains. The ranch houses were a small, deserted patch of weathered boards. The corrals were empty. Through the middle of the vast plain, a stream wandered, and even from the butte, Chinook could see the whiteness of the water. The prairie was dotted with scraps of hide, skulls, and scattered bones. The remnants of a once mighty herd, now dead and left to blend with the buffalo grass. It was a saddening and desolate scene. A sorry domain, no matter how large and how fertile.
We buried your granddad on that knoll behind the house. You want to go down there?
No. I'll go there tomorrow when I can tell him that it's done.
He looked away from Deke and in a muffled voice added,
"Where's that goddamn mine?"
They rode north for more than 3 miles and came out on a bluff. The mine was in a canyon. A stamp mill was banging harshly, grinding quartz to dust. Men were moving about the vats, in and out of the drifts and among the shacks, and they were all armed. A telescope told Chinook that the place was impregnable. A red-shirted guard sat at each end of the canyon. Kendall was taking no chances of a retaliation.
Pretty complete layout.
Freight in from the Missouri.
It must have taken out a lot of gold.
I don't know. They ship every stage, and the express box is always nice and heavy. Kendall ain't likely to let this slip out of his hands. Come to think of it, there'll be a stage through Bull Butte tonight.
Uh-huh. By the way, how often does that stage go through?
Twice a week. Why?
That isn't so good. Wells Fargo Express?
No, this is too far out for anything like that. Only private feeders.
Good. How do they ship their ingots?
Why, by the bank, I guess. I never noticed. What do you got in mind, Shannon?
Nothing definite. It's a cinch two men wouldn't stand a chance storming that mine. Suicide. Kendall's got too many guns around him all the time. Besides, killing Kendall won't straighten out everything.
Maybe I should have shot him today. I don't know. I kind of got upset when his two gunslingers came out of the saloon looking for him. I ain't so much with a shooting iron, you know?
Can't even load one, I'll bet.
Well, but you gotta admit, I figured those two gunslingers would blast us down if they ever so much as heard a hammer click.
Well, never mind. Killing Kendall's a last resort. First thing I've got to do is pay up to the bank.
You really think you can find $26,000?
I don't really think so. But damn it, Deke Murphy, me and Wildcat rode all the way from Arizona to Montana to settle up a score. Just because we arrived 24 hours before the hammer drop, isn't any reason to quit trying. I've got ideas, and my ideas lead me to Bull Butte.
Chinook slid back away from the rim, scowling thoughtfully.
How is it that this claim was right here all the time and nobody knew it till Kendall came along?
Well, hell, we knew about it. Everybody knew about it. But we're in the cattle business. We don't know anything about mines. Your grandpappy, he knew about it when he patched this range together. Old guy by the name of Stewart. He was here long before we was. Used to live up here at the mine. He'd pan some and sink his shaft a little deeper, but he never made much on it. Leastways, judging by how he used to weasel grub out of your grandpappy. Grub and tobacco. He was right glad to have the company, Stewart was. He'd been in these hills for years. He'd lived right here for 7. Great old guy. Lots of wild Indian yarns. Begged off your grandpappy all the time. Last winter, old Stewart died, and right afterwards, this Kendall appeared and started to work the diggings. Your grandpappy was gonna do something about it legal, if I remember, but, well, they shot him before he had a chance.
That doubles it.
Doubles what?
My reason for going to Bull Butte tonight.
I wouldn't show myself. Kendall's hell-bent on ventilating you considerable.
I don't doubt it. Now I see the extent of these workings. Tell you what, let's go someplace where I can get something to eat. Thinking always did give me a powerful appetite.
After 6 o'clock, it was Bull Butte's custom to get noisy. Guns were loose in the town this night. A target for ready lead was somewhere in the vicinity, and the Shoshone men were already spending on credit the bounty offered for a certain Shannon scalp. Chinook, the quarry, tied his horse Wildcat in a small clearing some distance from the town. He loosened the cinch and made sure the grass. Deke Murphy stood in the shadows watching Chinook, and he gave him a half salute.
I'll be back in a half hour. Wait for me, unless you hear a whole lot of gunfire.
Deke nodded dumbly. Chinook picked his way through the dark trees toward Bull Butte's main thoroughfare. The stage was not yet there. It would arrive, according to Deke, in about 2 hours and would depart after a short stop. It had to make a 115-mile run from dawn to dawn on an extremely bad road with only 2 relays. Chinook did not have long to wait. Kendall rode into the light on the other side of the street. Beside him and behind him were six men, either side of a pack horse. The black muzzles of rifles jutted out from the crooks of their arms. The midweek take of the Shoshone mine had arrived. The horses stopped in front of the bank. Lamplight flooded the building's hitch rack and walk, and Banker Borden came out.
Oh, you're just in time, Mr. Kendall. I was getting worried.
Oh, he's just been jumping at shadows,
said Jake Humphrey at Kendall's right.
You ain't seen anything of that young fool, have you, Borden?
Why, just before noon, he...
I know. I mean, tonight.
Well, I wouldn't carry things too far, Mr. Kendall. After all, you've got 20 of the hardest fighters this side of Dodge. And one man.
One bullet can do a hell of a lot of damage. Oh, don't get me wrong. Maybe you think I'm scared of the rat. I'm not. I'm just anxious to plug him and get him over with. I don't want any trouble. Not with the Shoshone running like she is.
Good, eh?
Unload her, Jake, and show him.
Jake and another man dragged the pack off the horse and with some effort carried it inside the bank. Presently, Chinook heard a vault door clang shut. Kendall and his men came out.
You, Steve, and you, Lippy, stay here and keep your eyes open.
That scalp money good for us?
It does.
Said Kendall, walking toward the Diamond Palace with the other four. Chinook surveyed the street again. On the other side of the sheriff's office, he saw a light and knew that Taggart was at home. A quick survey of the street showed him that the way was clear. He knocked gently upon the sheriff's back door. Taggart's semi-bald head appeared at the back window. Boots scuffed inside. The door let out a widening crack of light, and there was Sheriff Taggart. A scattergun clutched nervously to his heaving chest.
Shannon, you go away.
I got business. And if I should happen to come out on top of this heap, Sheriff, my memory will be pretty long.
Oh, come in, Mr. Shannon.
Sheriff Taggart looked forlornly at his scagger gun, realized that it was pointing directly at Chinook's checkered chest, and quickly propped it in a corner. Chinook entered and closed the door. He sat down at a table cluttered with dirty plates and pans and built himself a smoke. Taggart darted a glance in the direction of the noisy street as though he could see through the both inner and outer walls.
Taggart? Mm-hmm. My grandfather had more kindness than judgment sometimes.
Yes. Fine man, your grandfather. A gentleman of the old school. Splendid fellow. Have some business with me?
Yes. The circuit court stops here occasionally, at least when there's business to be done. Their records, or at least a schedule of business, a docket, should be in your possession. Give, Taggart.
Why, I believe...
Give.
Taggart shuffled into the outer office, and Chinook heard a safe door open and shut. Taggart came back laden with ledgers.
I am sure that this... that is, I might suggest that... You will probably find nothing there, Mr. Shannon.
Chinook was paying no attention to him. He swept back the smeared plates and stacked up the books. Starting with the top, he went along their backs with his finger. Finally, he found the one he wanted. Spreading it open, he rapidly rattled through the pages. Presently, Taggart was blasted down with a glare.
Taggart, you have been negligent in your duties. This entry states in so many words that the circuit court, at the request of my grandfather, placed a restraining injunction against the Shoshone Mining Company pending investigation of all titles, water rights, patents, and claims. It further states that the Shoshone Mining Company may continue to operate only insofar as minerals mined be placed in escrow pending the further findings of this court. You served that injunction?
Well, now, to be frank, Mr. Shannon, your grandfather was murdered, and I was so taken up with the investigation of his death that the matter quite simply slipped my mind.
I suppose so. And as there was no further complaint from this region, the circuit court has not been back since. Look here. Here's the injunction in an envelope, all ready for the serving, signed by the judge to be handed personally to Brad Kendall and operating from the date of issue. Taggart, we must be firm.
Oh, yes. Of course, quite right. Yes, yes indeed, Mr. Shannon.
I did not think that my grandfather would let this matter rest without a fight.
Oh, no.
Whether you know it or not, Taggart, there is a law, a federal law, about water. Huh? The Mining Act of 1872. Title 32, Chapter 6, Revised Statutes, Article 2339, specifically states that whenever any person in the construction of a ditch or canal injures or damages the possession of any settler on the public domain, the party committing such injury or damage shall be liable to the party injured for such injury and damage. It further states, Taggart, that such prior rights to water shall be protected in their vested rights and that the matter is within the province of a court.
Oh. My, Mr. Shannon, I did not know that you were a lawyer. Chinook omitted telling him that he had just then read the matter straight off the record. Chinook growled.
There's a lot of things you don't know, Taggart. And one of them is that you are going to serve this injunction.
Oh, of course. Of course, Mr. Shannon. However, I must act, unfortunately, on the morrow in the foreclosure of the, well, you know, slash S. You understand, Mr. Shannon, that the papers are already in Borden's hands, and I must go through with the formality.
I understand all that. Oh. But you are going to serve this injunction within the next 5 minutes.
What?
You're going to walk into your office, open the door, and send the first man who passes for Kendall. I will be standing right behind this door, looking through the keyhole with the muzzle of my gun accurately centered upon the middle of your flabby spine. One motion extra, or one too many blinks or gulps, and I'll plug you first. Kendall second, and then I'll take his men with your scatter gun as they rush in. On your horse, Sheriff.
Taggart developed an alarming case of palsy. Chinook flipped his peacemaker out of its holster, tossed it up in a spin, caught it, cocked. Taggart tried to protest. He dropped to his knees. He whined. He groveled and whimpered. Chinook began to count slowly.
One.
Taggart yelped in terror.
Two.
Flung into his outer office, shoved his face outside the front door, and spotted a passing Kendall gunman. Yes, send Kendall over here a second. The gunman went away. Taggart swept back, crept back in for the envelope and the injunction. Chinook handed it out, closed the door, and knelt at the keyhole. Kendall came in a few minutes later. He was thick and tipsy with rot-gut whiskey. Kendall missed Taggart's pallor, or possibly attributed it to the terror of the Kendall name.
What the hell's eating you, moss face?
I got a letter that I've been meaning to get to you.
Wailed Taggart, quickly thrusting the paper into Kendall's hand as though it was on fire. Kendall grunted and opened it. He read it three times, moving his lips as he read. And then gradually, its contents began to sink in.
God damn you for a blundering fool!
Volleyed Kendall, wide nostrils quivering, black teeth biting off the tails of the words.
What in the name of...
It was all unquotable. It treated Taggart's family tree from its inception, followed through several score generations, caught up with Taggart's personal appearance, his filthy habits, his general demeanor, and went on to revile Taggart's posterity. Rage dulled Kendall's wits. Otherwise, he might have guessed what lay on the other side of that door. He did not. He put a comma to his phrases by tearing up the injunction into small pieces, one at a time, and hurling them into Taggart's face With the injunction gone, Kendall promised lengthy vengeance, slow torture, and he expressed a wish to minutely examine Taggart's abdomen with a sharp knife. And finally, he went away, still roaring.
Yes!
Taggart closed the door, limped back into the room, moaning and whining. Chinook solemnly thanked him, and then just as solemnly said,
"And now about a star."
A star? Whispered Taggart, too weak from shock to talk out loud.
Sure. You got authority to swear in deputies. You're swearing me in as a deputy sheriff right now.
It won't do you any good. You'll be dead before morning. You heard what he said. I'll be dead and you'll be dead. And oh, why did you have to come into this country?
The star.
Taggart's resistance was gone. Protesting only with great feebleness, he fished a rusty badge out of his desk. Limply, he handed it to Chinook. Muttered some words, which Chinook took to be an administered oath, and then with terrific suddenness, Taggart collapsed in a chair and fumbled blindly for a whiskey bottle.
Thanks again, Sheriff. I knew my grandfather's choice would know how to do his duty like a man.
Oh, you think so?
I do. See you at the funeral.
What funeral?
I don't know just yet. But I'll see you there. Good night.
At 10 o'clock, about an hour after the stage had left Bull Butte, Bear Paw Canyon was filled with the clatter of hoofs and the jingle of chain and the groan and creak of ungreased springs. The four horses toiled through the dark. Chinook watched it come with immense satisfaction. He drew his peacemaker and stepped away from Wildcat and up on an overhanging boulder. Across the road, with Sheriff Taggart's axe sticking upright on it, lay an expertly felled pine. The stage could not go up the steep bank, nor could it move around the left because of the trees. The stage, as there was not room for a turn, would have to stop. Chinook crouched, waiting. Abruptly, the lead horse stopped, his mates bunched up. With a startled curse, the driver jerked upright. Instantly, the messenger leveled his gun, nervously on the watch.
"Tree down,"
spat the driver.
"Ain't been no wind,"
said the messenger in a high-pitched voice. The driver looped up the reins and stood up. Yellow light splashed on the bright axe.
"Road agents!"
yelped the driver, diving for his Henry rifle. The two stood there shivering in the chill night, staring around the stage at the tall, whispering pines. Minutes passed. Nothing happened.
"Some damn fool was just getting firewood or something."
"Oh, we better wait. You know why."
The driver waited, and still nothing happened.
"If this is a robbery, it's the funniest I ever saw. Hell with it. There ain't nobody here. Come on down and help me chop that damn tree out of the road."
"No, I got to stay here,"
said the messenger, glancing at the express box beside his boot.
"You know why."
"You're lazy, that's all,"
snapped the driver. Peevishly, he climbed down, taking a lantern with him, and walked forward to the log. It was not a very big tree, about 10 inches in diameter. Muttering to himself, he pried up the axe and fell to work. Presently, with a groan, that end splintered off and into the road. The wiry driver then tried to lift the log by himself, but it was too heavy for his small strength.
"Damn you, Bob! You come down here and quit that looking like a setter on a point. There ain't nothing gonna happen."
"Nah, I got to sit here."
"The sooner we get going, the better. And we ain't gonna get going if I can't move this log."
The driver stamped his boot and swore.
"I need help."
The messenger stayed tenaciously to his post. The driver argued and threatened. Then the coach creaked mysteriously. While the messenger was watching forward because that place had the most light on it, a sure and steady hand wrapped itself around the messenger's rifle barrel.
"Easy now."
"Jesus!"
chattered the messenger as the rifle left his hands and soared outward into the dark. The resulting crash of the Henry brought the driver up with a jerk.
"Easy! Shuck your guns, gentlemen.
The driver found himself staring into the glare of the lamps. He could not see anything on the box but two vague shadows, and he was not at all sure that one of them wasn't the messenger. Hurriedly, the driver shucked his guns.
Turn around.
Said Chinook, the driver turned.
I want you gentlemen to know that this isn't a holdup.
It don't look like no Sunday school picnic.
I'm doing this in the name of the law. Here, look at this star.
Anybody can tote a star.
I've been duly sworn, and I've got a paper which entitles me to confiscate this express box.
The messenger was very amazed to behold such a thoroughly authorized road agent.
Okay.
The horse moved in the trees. Deke Murphy came out, leading a pack animal. Duke reached up and lowered the express box down to the cross trees. And then he threw a knot around it to hold it there. And after that, he led the horse away. Chinook carefully felt along the box for other weapons. He found the driver's Henry rifle, which instantly followed the messenger's.
I'm covered from the woods, so don't you try anything.
He stood with his hands carefully held high. Chinook slipped down from the box into the large boulder. He sprinted for Wildcat, mounted, and spurred down the road. Chinook laughed into the crisp wind which cooled his face. He swung off into the timber, curved down a stream, and met Duke there after an exchange of locating whistles. He rode up to him. They continued at a brisk trot, going deeper into the canyon along the stream to cover their tracks. In a short while, they reached an overhanging cliff which gave protection from both the wind and sight. Deke lighted a small, almost invisible fire. Chinook picked up a big boulder and began to splinter the express box.
I still don't see how you can get away with it. I don't think there'll be enough money there to pay up half that loan. And Kendall's sure comb these hills for you now.
Well, we'll take that chance.
Said Chinook, smashing the box one last time. The lid fell apart. The small fire glittered on the metal. Chinook swiftly knelt beside the splintered loot. His eyes grew cold, and his hands were clenched.
That dirty, double-crossing coyote. He's outguessed me. He knew that I'd stop that stage. He even planned a hidden gunman to snipe me off if I popped up.
What's the matter?
This ain't gold. We've gone and robbed that stage of 100 pounds of lead.
The chill gray fingers of dawn pointed from the eastern horizon. Chinook lay upon a flat red chunk of granite on the tip of the Table Butte. His telescope followed the movement of a group of three Kendall riders. They were thoroughly combing the prairie and coulees for any sight of Chinook Shannon. Farther to the west, another group went through similar movements. Kendall was sparing no effort to locate his game. A rock moved behind Chinook. He whipped about, rolling into cover and snatching at his peacemaker, but it was only Deke.
I had a hell of a time getting back from Bull Butte. Kendall's even got his pump men scouring the country. I almost slammed straight into Steve and Lippy, but they didn't see me.
You get any news?
Well, not so very much. I got a hold of Sloppy Morris, the Diamond Palace barkeep. He's friendly, but he don't know much.
Deke sat down, produced some rocky biscuit and some jerked beef, and laid them on a stone. Chinook wolfed a sandwich down, sloshed it down with a swig from his canteen, and said,
"You find out anything at all?"
Deke grinned and then laughed.
Well, Sheriff Taggart, well, they run Taggart out of town last night, right after you left. Maybe they didn't run him out. Maybe he just thought it would be smarter to leave. Anyhow, the last anybody seen a Taggart, he was scorching dirt bound north.
Chinook laughed with him, quite heartlessly.
Well, he was bound to cut and run sometime. I guess I sort of gave him some momentum. You say Kendall's looking every place, huh?
Yep. He's madder than a gunshot grizzly about us sticking up that stage. Maybe he's peeved because you got away.
That's funny. I wonder just why he's so anxious to dry gulch me. I don't know such a hell of a lot. And I haven't got any case at all afternoon today. That is, in just 5 1/2 hours. Old man Time will take care of me for him. And 1 minute after 12, the benefits of all suits, liens, stock, and monies will pass forever from Shannon control into the hands of Borden. Kendall ought to let it ride.
Since she's worried. From a bluff back there, I counted 4 parties looking around, and Kendall himself was in one of them.
Wait a minute. Wait. Look here, Dick. Jesus Christ! I mean, oh, for God's sake! Dick, where's my horse?
Where you left it? What's the matter with you? Where are you going?
I'm heading straight up to the Shoshone mine.
What? You damn fool, they'll shoot you on sight. What in the name of common sense do you want at the mine?
Trail along!
Chinook scrambled down the slope of the butte and saddled Wildcat. Deke, with loud protests, could do nothing but mount and swing down the stream bed after Chinook. Chinook worked his way around the north side of Bull Butte several miles out from it, continued northwest, and finally arrived at the upper end of the canyon which contained the Shoshone mine. It was now 8:30, and the sun was growing warmer as it rose. Chinook watched his shadow shorten with great apprehension. When there was no shadow at all, his time of action was over, and there would be no shadow in just exactly 3 1/2 hours. As they parted, Deke complained.
Look here, Chinook. You still got plenty of time. We can pull out of this. I know we could head for Powder River. I know a place where we could get a couple of jobs.
Me and Wildcat rode all the way from Arizona to tell my granddad. Well, so long, Deke.
Riding carefully, Chinook approached the rim above the place that he had first spotted a guard. In a way, he had all the advantage with him. Kendall thought that the mine was the last place in the world for hunt for Chinook. Guards, workers, and gunmen, intrigued by a flat offer of $5,000 bounty, had scattered out with great enthusiasm. The guards were gone. Chinook was very relieved. Leaving Wildcat in an abandoned prospect hole, Chinook slipped down toward the shacks. Scouting the shacks with great care, Chinook located Kendall's office and slipped inside. He closed the door and he bolted it. In the corner squatted a black gold-trimmed safe, very battered, bearing the legend, Dreadnought Burglar-Proof Vault.
Damn you, I got a legal right to gut you. And I'll be damned if you recognize law any more than your master.
He opened the office door and looked out. No one was in sight. His glance rested upon a small building half buried in the ground, which flaunted a tattered red flag.
Ah.
He walked rapidly toward the small building's front and pried the door open. The acrid odor of dynamite hit him. He picked up a case, and he lugged it back to the office. He had seen it done before, but he had never tried it. So he took a copper cap and inserted the fuse into the end of it, and then tied it there with a string. He then tied 3 sticks together and laid them on top of the safe door. He opened the door and lighted the fuse and backed hurriedly outside. He rounded the corner of the bunkhouse and stopped. The explosion shook the camp and rocked that canyon echoes. Greasy smoke spewed forth from the shattered windows of the office, but he could not wait after that noise for the fumes to clear. Chinook plowed through the smoke to the safe. The safe contained no money. Chinook had known that it would not. Chinook scooped up vast quantities of papers and dumped them on the floor. Kneeling with the smoke choking him, he flipped through the documents. With eager fingers, he seized a mining patent and opened it. That was all very regular. It stated that George Stewart, having done $100 of improvement on his claim every year for 5 years, was thereby granted a patent upon it. It was signed by a peculiar mark, a crudely drawn pot on a cross-stick fire. Puzzled, Chinook frowned thoughtfully.
Stewart. George Stewart. All Stewarts known it. Well, for God's sake, his mark was a stew pot, short for stew, Stewart.
It was witnessed as a signature by Chinook's grandfather. Chinook thrust it into his batwing pocket and searched the pile again. At last, he uncovered a legal-looking document written in some graceful hand, dated some 6 months before, which seemed to be some sort of contract and mentioned the patent. It deeded the patent, it said, for a certain consideration to Paul Borden, Bull Butte Bank, and it was signed again with a stew pot. An added paper stated that the mine was hereby sold to Brad Kendall in the consideration of a certain sum and $1 silver. The hammer of hard-ridden horses thundered down the canyon. Chinook leaped up, started for the door, and saw Kendall at the head of a half a dozen men riding straight up at the office, guns drawn. Whirling, Chinook dived through the glassless rear window and hit running. 44 slugs plowed the ground close to his jangling jingle bobs. His checkered shirt tugged at his arm.
Kill him! Take your Henrys! Dismount! Kill him!
The six-gun fire let up for an instant. Chinook scrambled up the steep canyon wall and found Wildcat. Chinook mounted and without touching the stirrups and raked hard. A slug jolted into the saddle. Another screamed away from under Wildcat's chest, missing more by less than an inch. Chinook reached the rim and plunged along the crest, over and out of sight. Yells of anger exploded behind him, quickly blotted by the ring and clang of flying hoofs in swift pursuit. Chinook cut down toward the end of the canyon. He spotted Deke. Deke swung out of a coulee on his running mount, and he swerved in beside Chinook.
You got him on our necks! You find anything?
Yep!
What?
Ride!
They plunged down a bank, slashing through the ruined whitish Pan Creek and up the other side.
Where are we going?
Bull Butte!
Jesus!
Ride!
In a geyser of dust, they skidded down another ravine, turned and raced along the hard bottom, whisked around a curve between the banks, and straightened out running.
Prepare to shift horses!
Shift what?
Horses! This wildcat's easy recognized. Shift hats and shift horses. Nobody can catch you on Wildcat.
What the hell?
Stop! Shift!
Chinook flung himself off. He pulled Deke down, jammed on Deke's hat, and swung up on Deke's roan.
Head north! Head any place! They can't catch you on Wildcat. Keep going!
Who are you?
I'm leading. I'm heading for Bull Butte.
The thunder of the approaching ten grew loud in their ears. Deke dug spur. Wildcat loped up the bank toward the north, went over and leveled out, long legs eating space. Chinook went straight ahead, turned into a clump of tall alder trees, and drew rein. Kendall's bellow rose above the pounding hoofs.
There he goes!
Where's Deke?
To hell with Deke! Get that Shannon!
The men swept down the bank and up the other side, leaving a yellow haze of dust behind them. Their yells faded. Chinook neck-reined Deke's roan into the ravine bottom and went at a canter, unwilling to raise too much dust. Far north, he could see the small dots which were the rapidly disappearing horsemen. The cloud of their passage parted a little and showed one man sitting motionless on a horse behind the running others. Chinook put his telescope on that lone rider. Kendall had stopped. Why? Chinook headed toward the Bull Butte again. From time to time, he looked back. But he had gone a mile or more before he again saw Brad Kendall. With quirt and spur, Kendall was racing toward Bull Butte, almost parallel to Chinook. They saw each other at the same time. Kendall was evidently more interested in getting to Bull Butte than he was in nailing the man who he took to be Deke Murphy. The blasting at the mine and this ride had taken time. Too much time. The sun was spinning almost overhead, and the flying shadow under the roan's belly was almost at its minimum. Chinook Shannon's time as a cattle keen was drawing to a close. Chinook applied quirt and sped along not much higher than the tops of the waving brown buffalo grass. Backed with rolling, blanketing dust, Chinook's lathered roan set all 4 feet and skidded to a stop outside the bank, reared, and came down again. The Diamond Palace doors crashed outward, and Jake Humphrey's fat, meat face opened to admit,
"Shannon! Everybody out!"
Jake's hand dug faster than it had ever dug before, and the short gun spewed flame. The bullet passed the instant after Chinook left the saddle. Across leather, Chinook chopped down. Jake spun around in a half circle, a bullet through the shoulder. Chinook dived into the bank, and the frightened roan left hurriedly for a more peaceful country. Borden stood halfway up at his desk, and then his legs became paralyzed, and he stood there just like that, with half-crooked knees. Chinook presented a horrifying sight. Smoke drooled from the big peacemaker's muzzle. Psychic flame shot out of Chinook's angry eyes.
You crook!
Another horse was arriving. Chinook went past Borden like a wind devil, upsetting chairs and sending paper flying in every direction. Borden thought his day of judgment had arrived. His knees finally caved. But by that time, Chinook was past the sprawling cashier and into the open door of the big steel-lined vault. Chinook whirled and watched the door. Kendall flashed by outside, wheeled, and threw himself off his horse and started for the bank door. A faraway yelp from one of Kendall's men cried,
Shannon's in there! Look out!
Kendall dodged and ducked out of sight. Boots sounded on the boardwalk, and then everything was still. Except everything but the big pendulum on the clock. Chinook could see from the vault it was 11:50, and with a carefree, heartless tick-tock, tick-tock, the swinging brass disc was pushing up the seconds and minutes at an alarming rate. The vault door was about 3 feet by 6, and the vault itself was about 8 by 8. As Chinook had noted at first glance, the place was a perfect fort. Unless somebody outside began to play billiards with bullets and carom them off the steel walls.
Where is he?
He's in the vault. Would you please get him out of there? I don't like to have him in there. He's disrupting business, Kendall.
I'll disrupt his business. Get down.
Boots scraped. A board creaked.
Shannon, come out of there with your hands high, or I'm coming in after you.
Come ahead,
said Chinook, audibly cocking his peacemaker. A .44 barked thunderously. The slug hit the steel lining, changed course, hit the back wall, shot sideways and up, embedding itself in some sacks, which stood upon a shelf. Black, sandy stuff trickled out and down Chinook's neck. Another shot whipped wickedly through the place. Chinook's ears hurt with the sound of it. He had to have more cover. Kendall could stand there and do that all day, and at least one shot would take effect. Chinook reached up and pulled at the leaking sack. It was very heavy. Placing it on the floor and lifting down others, Chinook built himself a barricade about 3 feet high and lay down behind it. Kendall steadily combed the walls with ricocheting slugs. Finally, he stopped and listened.
I guess that got him.
Chinook waited, hopefully, but Kendall evidently was not sure. The clock on the wall said 11:58. A rifle barrel appeared across the street, jutting out of a window. Chinook caught a glimpse of it and raised up. The gunman was trying at a carom at the ceiling, which would be extremely fatal. Chinook had to fire. He slammed the slug through the bank glass. The rifle hastily withdrew, and Kendall growled,
"You come out, or we'll burn you out."
"Burn? But my bank?"
"I'll pay for your loss. It won't be much. It's worth plenty of dollars to me."
"No!"
shrieked Borden from behind his desk.
"No! No!"
"What the hell's the matter with you?"
"There's plenty the matter with him."
"Kill him. Kill him, Kendall. He's a mad dog. He'll shoot all of us. He's crazy."
"Like a fox. You know what's in here, Kendall?"
"I'll find out after we carry you away feet first."
The spurting black stuff in the bag stunk Chinook's eyes. He rubbed them clear and spat to rid his mouth of the gritty substance.
"Kendall, I even hate to see a killer and a crook make a jackass out of himself."
"Isn't there some way to get him?"
"Sure. I can be got. Just walk right in here and see for yourself."
Kendall had stopped to load. He started shooting again. Chinook reached up between shocks and raked out file drawers, letting them scatter on the floor.
"What are you doing in there?"
"I'm a bank examiner. And I'm busy examining a bank."
"Kill him, Kendall!"
"Ah!"
said Chinook, delighted at a find.
"I've reached K, and here I find Kendall. Kendall, Brad, Shoshone Mining Company. Dear Mr. Kendall, I have a very rich mine here in Bull Butte, which, after your disappointments in the Bitterroot, should improve your fortunes."
"Kill him!"
"You hadn't ought to keep copies of your letters,"
reproved Chinook, rattling paper. Kendall stopped shooting. The clock on the wall said 11:56. Chinook chortled.
"And listen to this. Received March 3rd of Paul Borden, Bull Butte, Montana, 2,500 head of prime beef at $15 a head."
"Oh!"
"So that was it. You rustled /ass cattle after my grandfather was killed. 4,000 head there were. Maybe 1,500 died from that Pan Creek cyanide.
and you sold the other 2,500 and nobody ever thought to count the dead stock. My, 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 Borden. You certainly keep your records in fine shape.
What the hell are you into, Shannon?
Papers! Come on in and look them over. I won't shoot you unless I get a good look at you.
You won't shoot nobody. Hey, Lippy! Get outside the window where he can't see and bounce a few off his ceiling.
You bet!
Said Lippy, outside.
Well, 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 looky here. My grandfather had 3,000 in a checking account, and it's still there!
It's been subtracted from the loan.
Wailed Borden, squirming so much that he moved the desk a little. Chinook laid aside the file, reloaded his peacemaker, and ducked a slug from the street. With quick throwdowns, Chinook blasted the whole bank window out. Glass spattered. Lippy, badly cut, yelled and retreated. It was 3 minutes of 12. Chinook pulled out more files. In spite of everything he had found, he had not bettered his position in the least. Kendall evidently knew all about the whole transaction.
Funny.
What's funny?
The way you foxed me on that gold shipment.
The way I what?
Chinook grinned wickedly to himself and patted his barricade.
You were shipping gold concentrate, weren't you, Kendall?
You ought to know.
I do. But somehow, Kendall, I can't find any receipts from the government in here.
I don't care what you can't find.
Please, Mr. Kendall, kill him quick!
No government receipts in here. Not a one. Just a whole lot of gold concentrate. Maybe $200,000 worth.
What?
I said, there's no use shooting in here at me. I'm laying behind $200,000 worth of gold concentrate. At least that's what Borden's records show. And it sure looks like it, too. Good, solid stuff. I'm glad Borden kept it.
Borden? Borden kept it?
Sure. You gave him gold concentrate to keep in his vault for shipment on the stage. He shipped lead bars to a friend in some other bank farther north. Borden paid your men for you, advanced you all the money you needed, gave your receipts for the gold, and deposited the amount to your account. Then Borden was all set to get you killed, just like he got my grandfather killed. Snake out with all this gold and...
Borden? Is Shannon telling the truth?
I swear to God, he's lying.
Not only that, but Borden never owned the Stewart claim. Not a square foot of it. He had that patent here for safekeeping, and when he persuaded you to kill off my grandfather, Borden forged a second agreement with a stewpot signature. Overlooked a witness for it, which it has to have to be legal, and unloaded it on you. Soon as Borden foreclosed on the slash S, the claim reverted to him. And even if he did sell it ahead of time, when his plans about killing you, Kendall, materialized, he had a legal right to all that range, the mine, this money, which was to be held in escrow and later given to the slash S in damages.
A short, hard explosion jarred the bank. A Derringer leveled above the desk for a second shot. Kendall grunted. Boots hit the board hard. Kendall, clutching at his stomach, fighting to stay upright, staggered into view. Borden bobbed into sight, curling smoke out of his Derringer's barrel.
Damn you, Borden. Damn you. You double-crossed your last...
Borden was a sick green color. Kendall tried to level his .44. Borden was shaking. Kendall was dying on his feet, his eyes glazed with concentration. Borden turned and tried to shoot. Kendall's .44 roared. Borden's face was a smashed blot. He dropped across the desk. Guns racketed out in the street. Chinook strode forward to the shattered window. The sound increased in volume. Hoofs clattered. Men yelled with dust rolling behind them. The late Brad Kendall's riders fled the length of the town. Jake, Lippy, and Steve grabbed mounts from the hitch rack and swung up and away.
Kendall's dead!
They were gone, and from the upper end of the street came hoofbeats again. A compact group of horsemen came to a halt in front of the bank. Deke and Taggart were riding on either side of a solemn-faced, frock-coated gentleman. Chinook knew none of the others, but the party had come armed for war. Chinook stopped outside.
Shannon, where's Kendall?
Dead.
Where's Borden?
The guy at the bottom of this? Dead.
At the bottom of it?
Said the frock-coated man.
But I see here, when Sheriff Taggart routed me out this morning in Bannock, he said that Kendall...
Chinook must have the goods. He wouldn't lie to you, Judge.
Judge?
Yes, Judge Olson and a few friends. You are Chinook Shannon?
I am.
And you have everything cleared up and under control?
Everything is in order,
said Chinook, holstering his peacemaker with a final looking thrust.
Well, as a matter of form, we'll convene a court. I haven't had a session here for quite some time, Shannon, waiting for you. But it looks like you beat me to it. Rather disliked the idea of taking the initiative when Shannon was concerned. Gentlemen, it appears that the shooting is over. After I sign a few death certificates and such, we'll adjourn to the bar.
A splendid idea.
And the court adjourned to the Diamond Palace Saloon to drink to the health of Chinook Kent Shannon, Cattle King.